How do you handle criticism? What do you do with negative people? How about judgmental people? Now let me turn it around. Would anyone in your life consider you negative, critical, judgmental? And if so, what are you going to do about it? That's what we're going to talk about on today's program. Jesus Christ can take all of our struggles with negativism and criticism and hostility and turn them into stepping stones of deep communication. Join me, won't you? The reading of the Word of God comes from the first portion of the 7th chapter of Matthew. It continues our series of messages on the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus said, "Judge not, that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' and look, there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Do not give what is holy to dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces." I pray that the Holy Spirit of God will take this word now and use it, give it contemporary impact, so that we can hear what God has to say to us right now. Let us pray. O gracious God, we've made the household of God a house of judgment. We have taken communication and blocked it because of our negativism. We have destroyed the lives of people because of our hostility and our judgmentalism. Come to us now in this moment and help us to discover how we can live lives free of judgmentalism. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The body language between the couple was icy. I could tell the minute they walked into my study that something was wrong. It was obvious that they were out of communion with God and out of communication with each other. I asked them to sit down, and they made their way to the couch in my study. It's a long couch, and one sat on the furthest end and the other on the furthest other end, and they glared at each other. I sat across from them, and the conversation was very much like watching a ping pong game, trying somehow to get them to edge closer to one another, and that didn't seem possible. And so finally I looked at the husband and I said, "Whatever happened to the communication of your marriage?" And he said, "Criticize, criticize, criticize. All she ever does is criticize." Well, that's the beginning of conversation. And then I looked over at the wife, inviting her analysis. And she said, "Judge, judge, judge, judge. All he ever does is judge." And I want you to know, Pastor, that my criticisms are not as half as bad as his judgments. What would you have done with that conversation? I overheard two friends talking. One was being vitriolic in his criticism and judgments. And the other finally said, "Hold off, Mr. Perfect. What right do you have to judge?" And that's the question we need to answer. What right do we have to judge? Life is filled with evaluations. How can we get away from it? We go into a fruit stand and we have to evaluate which apple is rotten and which one is good. And we make a judgment and buy the good one and not the rotten one. Nothing wrong with that, is there? Every day we have to evaluate people. And with the gift of discernment, discern those whom we can support and those whom we cannot. We evaluate candidates and decide which are authentic and which are not. We decide day by day what's maximum and what's inadequate. When is it that we pass over that invisible line and our evaluations and our insights become negative, hostile judgments? When does it happen for you? I need to ask for your permission. I want to coin a new word, and I can't do that unless you give me the permission to do it, because we have to share in the coining of new words. But this is one I hope sticks. The word is plankaited. Now, many of you know about truncated. To truncate is to cut off, to shorten, to snub off. Now, a plankaited vision, like a truncated vision, is shortened. Only a plankaited vision is much more serious. Jesus said, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you'll be able to see to take the speck out of your brother's eye. We want to talk about what that means. For I suspect that every one of us here has the problem with plankaited vision. That is, there are things that are wrong inside of us that make us judgmental and hostile, keep us from seeing people as they really are, and as a result, we become negative, critical, judgmental people. How do you feel about that? Is that true? Jesus said, judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. That expresses his profound concern about our judgments. Now, how do we put it all together? Jesus judged. He looked at Herod Antipas and said, you fox! I guess that's a judgment, isn't it? Or if you want to intensify it just a little bit, read over in his message where he said to the Pharisees, you blind guides, you whitened sepulchres, you hypocrites. I guess you might call that criticism. However you slice it, Jesus was very incisive. But he was the Son of God. And he also said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that those who believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For the Son came not to condemn the world, but that they might have life. Only God has the right to judge. And he entrusts to us the gift of discernment, so that we can guide our lives. But we never possess the authority to cut someone off as of no value, as someone with whom we want to have nothing else to do, and someone who has no potential. That's what a judgment is. A plankaited vision is one that cuts another person off, holds them at arm's length, demeans them, turns them off, saying, listen, because of what you said or did, I'm finished with you. Any of you feel that way about anybody? Who's cut off? Who's turned down because of your judgments? We question. But now we have to talk about, why do we judge people? I think the first reason is ineptness. We simply do not know how to help people do what is best for them other than criticizing them. What we are doing when we criticize another person or judge them or constantly gig them along with negativism is simply to say, I don't know any other way to get people to do what's best. What an admission. We've lost the exciting power of motivation by love, of being with people in such an exciting way that they say, oh, that's what life is. That's the way I want to live. Or being able to describe to them what God could do with their life if they dared to trust Him, so that they get a vivid picture of what they could do and be, and they move forward as a result of that. How different than most Christians. We constantly go around like a pious policeman saying, aha, I want to catch you with the goods. We always want to expose people for what they didn't do or didn't say or did not perform. And so we become judges and put people at arm's length. We plankate them and do away with them. And Jesus said, I have entrusted to you the keys of the kingdom. What you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and what you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Can you imagine? The power given to you and me. We have the power either to turn on or turn off people. An awesome power had been given to the Caesars. They could watch a gladiator in the arena, and in the midst of a battle, just before the defeated gladiator was either to live or die at the sword of his conqueror, he would look up at Caesar, and with a gesture, Caesar could say, life, death. Do you realize you're doing that every day? In your office, with your family, with your friends, constantly you're saying, life. Or, listen, buddy, after what you've done and what you've said, you are no good, and I want nothing to do with you anymore, and I don't care whether you live or die. Now, we'd never say that. And we hide it behind all sorts of pious language and all sorts of religious looks. But as far as any kind of energy being communicated in loving and caring and enabling, that's what our eyes are saying by our judgment. We're inept, but we're also jealous. So often the reason that we judge other people and are critical of them is that we're terribly jealous of them. Because we don't have their gifts or aren't able to do what they do, we criticize what they do. T.S. Eliot said, here's the greatest treason, to do the right thing for the wrong reason. And very often we say the right thing in criticism, but for the wrong reason. There's so much bad in the best of us and so much good in the worst of us that it ill behooves any of us to criticize the rest of us. And every so often we just have to go back and sit down with Robbie Burns, and in our critical hearts he says, oh, what some power the gift to give us to see ourselves as ither see us. It would many a blunder free us. Indeed it would. Indeed it would. But a deeper reason that we are critical is because we see in other people the things that are wrong inside of ourselves. That's what Paul put his finger on in the first two verses of the second chapter of Romans. He said, wherefore, O man, why do you judge? You're doing the very same things yourself. I believe that the reason for cankerous criticism and negativism is that we are upset by something a person has done that we wanted to do or were afraid to do, or a person has done something that we were tempted to do and are afraid that by observing it, we might do it too. Or because we know that inside of ourselves are the seeds of defection that we see in that person. And the only way we can deal with it, to keep it in perspective, is to judge it, be negative, be hostile, be angry. But all of the time, though we may not have had the courage to do the terrible thing that we criticize, or the insecure little thing, the minutia that we criticize, but we're really guilty of it nonetheless. You see, Jesus has really exposed us when he said, to think a thing is as bad as doing it. The thing that we criticize that other people do, most of us have done over and over again in our imagination. And the only way we can deal with it is by judging them. What we're really doing is expressing our own anger and hostility toward ourselves. Is that too severe? Could that be true? I wonder. Competitiveness is another reason that we judge. We need to get people down to size. Will Durant said, "What a tragic way to compliment yourself by criticizing someone else." I believe that. Do you ever do it? Where you can make a subtle comment to another person, a gossip, a judgment, and suddenly you have destroyed what a person has spent his life developing and building. I say, if we are to be in Christ, we will come to the place where we never say anything about another person that we have not first said to that person and discovered the way to say it. That sure cuts down the criticism and the gossip. But let's go deeper. Jesus said, first take the plank out of your own eye before you fuss around with a speck in somebody else's eye. What did he mean by that? What he wanted people to know was that they would be judged on their judgments, but also that the way to take care of judgments was to pay the cost of involvement, which meant to take whatever it is in our lives that keeps us from people or from God and surrender that to God. And then we will be able to see people as they are and minister to them. I call you to be a part of the Royal Order of Speck Removers. How about that? But you can't see the speck until you get rid of the plank in your own eye. Remember the blind man who came to Jesus? Jesus anointed his eyes and he said, "What do you see?" And he says, "I see trees as people walking." And then Jesus said, "Oh, you need more than that. Let me heal you again." And he gave him a second touch. And then the man saw people as they were. A second touch, once more with healing. Jesus is able to take us whose vision is half healed and help us to see people as they really are. Are you willing to give the plank in your own eye to him? Then you see, you can help people take the speck out of their own eye. But having taken the plank out of your own eye, you will be tenderized and sensitized with empathy and openness and concern to be able, in relationship with people, to help them. Now move on. Jesus said, don't throw what is holy to dogs, and don't cast your pearls before swine. Now dogs and swine had something in common. They were both terms for the non-Hebrew, person who was not a part of the family of God. And Jesus said, don't take meat off the altar and throw it out to the pariah dogs. And likewise, don't take pearls and throw them to swine. Swine can't be fed. There's no nutritional value in a pearl and a swine. They'll trample it under their feet and they'll turn because you didn't give them an acorn and they'll tear you apart. What he's really meaning is this: you can say too much too soon. The people who have a right to give any kind of evaluative judgment are those who have paid the price of long-lasting, caring, deep, abiding relationships. The only way we ever have a right to make a critical, insightful evaluation of another person that a person will be able to appropriate, not as a pearl, but as an acorn filled with protein, is after that person knows that we would live or die for him or her, that we're involved and caring, we'll stay with them regardless of what happens. Ah, but to do that, we need a second healing, a second touch from the Master. So very often we flip off our insights and our evaluations without really seeing into the heart of a person. Hear this. People do what they do because of what they are, and they cannot change what they do until they change what they are, and only God can change what they are. And rather than fussing around with the surface things that trouble us, let's get at what they are and introduce them to the power of God, for only with God can they change what they are in order to change what they do. I have three questions for you, and I pray to God that everyone can answer yes. I want you to say it in your soul, and then I want to hear you say it out loud. Are you willing to surrender your judgments to the ultimate judgment of God and stop judging people, cutting them off with your judgments? Secondly, are you willing to take the plank out of your own eye and ask for a second touch of healing? And lastly, are you willing to give yourself to people so that within the context of a deep, loving relationship, you can say what you have to say? Three yeses. That's what the Lord wants. Say it in your soul. Now say it out loud. Yes, say it.
Yes,
yes, say it.
Yes,
say it.
Yes.
Yes, Lord. Yes.